stop. All engine stops.
Phaser crew, stand ready.
Bridge to phaser crew, stand ready.
Forward phaser will comply. All weapons at operational ready.
Yes, Mr. Spock, fascinating is the word for the music we just heard from that clip from the Corbomite Maneuver, Episode 3 of Star Trek. In this video, we'll be looking into the life, career, and legacy of the composer who wrote that iconic music and went on to score the most episodes, 12 in all, of Star Trek. In speaking of the several composers who contributed to Star Trek, show producer Robert Justman said that his first choice, always, unless there was a particular reason, was Fred Steiner, who caught the inner being of Star Trek. He described Steiner as the John Williams of that time, with broad, sweeping themes and very melodramatic style of music. While it was Alexander Courage who birthed the musical character of Star Trek, Fred Steiner brought it to maturity. So, who was this guy? Frederick Steiner was born February 24, 1923, in New York to George and Adele Steiner, both immigrants from Hungary. His father was an accomplished violinist, conductor, and film composer, having studied music in Budapest under Zoltán Kodály. Maybe you've heard of Do, Re, Mi, and the hand signals? Well, Kodály went on to develop that system of music education. Growing up in Manhattan in a musical family, it was no surprise on his choice of profession, even though his dad discouraged it. Young Fred began playing piano at the age of 6 and cello by the age of 13. He immersed himself in his father's recordings of orchestral and chamber music. He earned a scholarship and his degree in composition from Oberlin Conservatory of Music at the age of 20. Twice he attempted to enlist in the war effort, and twice he was denied 4F due to poor eyesight. Well, he soon began writing and arranging scores for several New York-based live radio broadcasts under Nathan Van Cleve. In 1947, he left New York for Hollywood and began pioneering the early days of live television as an arranger, conductor, and composer. Then went on to such shows as Gunsmoke, Rawhide, The Andy Griffith Show, The Twilight Zone, and many others. One of his most famous compositions is the swinging, bluesy Park Avenue Beat. Never heard of it? I bet you have. From this TV classic. Screen on, Mr. Sulu. Well, if not that, how about this little animated kids show? Fred Steiner was recommended to Star Trek by CBS music director Lud Gluskin on the strength of his Twilight Zone work, basically taking over for Alexander Courage, who, of course, gave us the iconic Star Trek theme music and cues for several first season episodes. Well, the video you're watching now is in no small part inspired by this excerpt from Jeff Bond's interview with Dr. Steiner in 1999, in which he said, "I feel strongly that not enough attention has been paid to the Star Trek music. Most of the people I've spoken to emphasize very strongly that the music was responsible for a great percentage of the success of the mood and the atmosphere of the series." And of course, that's only right. That's what film music is all about. When Fred Steiner came into the production team, he hit the ground running. For season one, he composed music for Charlie X, Mudd's Women, The Corbomite Maneuver, Balance of Terror, and What Are Little Girls Made Of? This list would later include his masterful work adapting Goodnight Sweetheart for The City on the Edge of Forever. His music was richly orchestral, often with dark and heavy textures in brass and low strings. August-September of 1966 was a very busy time for Steiner, the production team, and the members of the American Federation of Musicians, the AFM. In the span of about a month, all the musical scores for 8 episodes were recorded. This included one marathon session on September 20th, in which the music for Balance of Terror, What Are Little Girls Made Of, and The Corbomite Maneuver were all recorded on the same day. Talk about overtime. Well, this one session gave us the unforgettable and heart-pounding music for the Cube Buoy Menace from The Corbomite Maneuver. Check this out.
Radiation increasing. Power astern, half speed. Half speed. Radiation nearing the tolerance level.
Still coming. Gaining on us.
Engines astern, full speed.
Full speed.
Range 125 meters now.
Okay, that same session also gave us the Romulans and their theme. And not to be outdone, they knocked out the raucous, timpani-driven Rook Attacks cue that was heard many times in Season 1 and then recorded as a library cue that was used in Season 2. I'm sure you've heard this killer cue.
Sir, I respectfully decline.
Very well, you've earned the consequences. This court is in recess.
Just a lot.
This is the Hall of Audiences.
Open it.
But this is laundry.
Open it.
When a great theme comes along, the veteran film composer knows how to use and reuse it so that you'd never realize it. In this transporter room scene, Scotty and Dr. McCoy are barely able to think when Mudd's women are first beamed aboard. Listen first for the flute duet.
It's all right, darlings. We're in good hands.
Bridge to transporter room.
Clearing the asteroid belt now, Captain.
Okay. Now listen for the same duet played in the strings.
One of them in my cabin immediately. Correction. I want them there where they can walk or not. Kirk out.
That fella sounded a mite upset, didn't he?
Yes. Yes, they are.
Listen now for the solo clarinet playing the same theme, only slower and more melancholy.
And Bones, what if I'm wrong?
Captain, I don't really expect an answer.
Well, Bob Justman felt the music for Star Trek needed to be more on the nose, that power counted more than subtlety. Fred Steiner recalled Gene Roddenberry saying he didn't want boops and beeps music, but adventure music, Captain Blood in space, that kind of thing. Well, making deadlines for Star Trek was a challenge. For one thing, composing the music itself was a challenge. It was a lot of complex music, very creative, and to write it out for 25 musicians, and there was maybe 10 days to do it in. So Steiner and many of the other composers worked with an orchestrator who would turn his composition sketches into session-ready scores. Oh, and the pay was terrible. Often the orchestrator would be paid more than the composer. Despite it all, and contrary to the Hollywood stereotype, Steiner was known for his down-to-earth personality. Film historian Tony Thomas wrote in 1991, in a profession often marked with personality conflicts and frayed nerves, Steiner is notable for his even temper and affable nature. It is no exaggeration to claim him as one of the best liked men in the film music community. Well, for season two, Steiner composed music for Who Mourns for Adonis, Mirror Mirror, By Any Other Name, and the adapted Star-Spangled Banner cue for the Omega Glory. In season three, he wrote for Spock's Brain and Elan of Troyes, which was arguably some of his finest work. Post-Trek, Fred Steiner lectured in composition at the University of Southern California and earned his Ph.D. in musicology there for his dissertation on the work of legendary film composer Alfred Newman. He co-founded the Film Music Society, and in 1985, get this, he earned an Academy Award nomination for his work on The Color Purple. Well, way back in the late 1950s, Mr. Steiner moved his family to Mexico City, where he worked for about 2 years to compile and archive Latin American music for government-sponsored TV documentaries. Something of that local culture in Mexico attracted him back for his retirement. And on June 23rd, 2011, Dr. Steiner passed away, leaving his wife of 64 years, Shirley, and two daughters, two grand and two great-grandchildren. Well, I really like it. If you have any comments or questions, feel free to leave one. Oh, and I found a great in-depth interview online done in 2003 by the Television Academy Foundation, about a four-hour interview with Dr. Steiner. The link is included below. Hey, thanks for watching. Trek long and prosper. We'll see you again soon.